You guys are in for a treat this morning. Can I tell you, it is a great Sunday to be here. And we have the awesome privilege of hearing our executive pastor this morning, which is Alejandro. But before you cheer for him, let me just tell you a little bit about Alejandro. He's really funny. He has a great sense of humor. But besides that, he loves you guys and he loves our church. And he is very part-time, but he comes and he serves and his heart is here. And I'm so thankful for that. He does a lot of things behind the scenes that people don't really know what he does, but his fingerprints is all over it. And if you were to ask our staff, if you were to ask anybody on our staff, like, what is Alejandro? They would say this. They would say that he has inspired us to be better leaders, that he is our biggest cheerleader, that he believes in us and he believes in our church. And it is an awesome privilege for us to hear him this morning. So can I tell you, like, be with him, amen him, clap for him, cheer him on. It's a great word. I've heard it once this morning. It's going to be even better this afternoon. Go ahead and give a round of applause to Alejandro.
Yo, 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 yo. What's up, guys? Yo, hey, hey, hey. Who's excited to be in church today? Oh, all right. I'm telling you, 11 o'clock, y'all crushed the 9 o'clock. Let me just keep it real. Man, I'm excited to be here, so excited. For those watching online, I got some friends all over the country watching. So, guys, love you. If you're watching, make sure to comment, like, and subscribe. I'm just joking. Some of y'all get that. Man, super pumped to preach today. Super excited. Thank you for Matt and Lisa. Thank you, Chris. Thank you, sir. Sneak a little snake. Man, so I'm really excited. I should probably open this because all my notes are in here. I love New Vintage. We came here in 2017 and been serving ever since. And then the role turned to kind of volunteering into the executive pastor role. My background's running an agency, and I run an advertising agency. And so when you go to Amazon or Nordstrom or other sites like that, and then you go to another site, and you're like, I was just looking at those Crocs on Amazon. That's kind of the stuff we do. You might not like that, but we follow you around on the internet and try to sell you a lot of stuff. So forgive me. But so run an agency. And today, super honored that Pastor Matt and Lisa would let me share the stage and share with you guys, because I think I have something that's going to be challenging, y'all. Like, y'all got to be ready, because, like, I'm usually, that she said funny. Maybe I might be funny, but I want to challenge you guys to press on, because what we're going to be talking about today is Joshua and Israel. They're on the brink of promise. This is where they basically got to cross the Jordan River, and they're kind of on the brink of their promise. God saved them from slavery, and they're in the middle somewhere, and they're on the brink of promise, and they're in the middle of their past and future promise. But before we talk about Joshua and the river and how it relates to us today, I want to kind of give a backstory to how this came about to be. And man, I love New Vintage. I really do. It's so great seeing Andrea, my wife's cousin, singing up there, harmonizing, and little harmonies. So God creates Adam and Eve. They sin. God ends up choosing Abraham because of his faith. God tells Abraham, go, and then I'll show you the place. There's a level of faith. And because of his faith, God says, you're going to be the father of many nations. I'm going to give you a promised land, but before you go to the promised land, I'm actually going to take you to another land, and you're going to be slaves for 400 years. Very encouraging God. Thank you. But he said, I'm going to deliver you from that and then, you know, have you go into the promise. That promise goes from Abraham, as he changed his name from Abram to Abraham, to Isaac, then to Jacob. Jacob had Joseph, and Joseph had this really cool Michael Jackson-looking jacket that was colorful and so cool that his brothers threw him in jail, and he ends up being thrown into slavery because of his brothers and rises to the second in command in Egypt. His family ends up going to Egypt because they need food, and Joseph sees them and shows mercy on that. Isn't it funny how sometimes people do things in another life or in the past or whatever, and it's really easy to kind of hope for justice and, man, they're going to get theirs. But we got to be like Joseph and show mercy because God's changed us and transformed us. And so he shows mercy and brings them into the family in Egypt, and God's family starts to grow like a wildfire, and the Pharaoh does not like this. So he oppresses them. They end up in slavery. Just like God had said, and at the time, God raises up Moses, and this is the generation right before Joshua, the protagonist that we're going to be talking about today. And God tells Abraham, Moses tells Abraham, let my people go. And he says no, and then the plagues come, and then he lets the people go. And you guys have seen the movie. I feel bad for Joshua, because Joshua is actually the one that takes them to the promised land, but Moses gets all the movies. You know, we got Prince of Egypt and all these different movies, but Joshua takes them in. And so there were plagues, and they end up going, the Red Sea parts, and they're here, right about 11 miles from the promise. Moses gets the Ten Commandments. He sends 10 spies to this promised land flowing with milk and honey, and he sends 12 spies, and what ends up happening is 10 of them come back and are like, they're too big, they're going to attack us, they're going to kill us. And they start kind of yapping their mouth and, as I like to say, bumping their gums and start telling everybody that, oh my God, we cannot go, and start spreading this to millions of people. And Caleb and Joshua are like, no, we can stand up. We trust God. We have faith. We need to go to the promised land, the land that God had promised us. And a lot of times what keeps us from our promises is listening to the wrong people. Fake news, social media posts, you know, and we got to listen to the people around us that say, you know what, we trust in God. We got your back. So they're in this middle. And because they don't go 11 miles, they wander. They're 11 miles away, and they wander for 40 years. A generation starts to die off, and God tells Moses that you're not going to go in. The guy that brought him out, the leader, the visionary, says you're not going to go in. The first verse in Joshua 1, if you have your Bibles, it literally says, Moses, my servant, is dead. Like, God comes, talks to Joshua, Moses, my servant, is dead. A lot of pretty straight up, direct, blunt, harsh tone God has here. And this is where we're at in the story. And if you have your Bible again, turn to Joshua 1. It says, after the death of Moses, a servant of the Lord said to Joshua, the son of Nun, my assistant, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise, go over this Jordan, you and all this people, into the land that I am giving to them, the people of Israel. So God is wanting to partner with Joshua to take his people to the promised land. Every place that the sole of your foot would tread upon, I have given to you, just as I promised Moses, from the wilderness to Lebanon, as far as the great river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites to the great sea. He's being specific of where their land is at, which is amazing that they're there today. A nation that has almost had its language extinct over the last 50 to 100 years. It's desolate, but the people of Israel coming down, the promise of God 2,000 years later, still coming to pass. No man shall stand before you all the days of your life, just as I was with Moses. So I will be with you. I will never leave you or forsake you. Be strong and courageous, for you shall cause this people to inherit the land I swore to their fathers. Real quick. For you shall cause this people. Sometimes the Christian walk, I get saved, and I'm good. I go to church, I volunteer every once in a while, and I'm good. But there's more. God wants more for us. He wants to take us into the promises that he's given us. And a lot of times, the powerful thing he says, you are going to cause people to inherit their promise. And so how are we causing other people? Are we causing them to inherit? Are we causing them and pointing them to Christ? Are we causing them to do nothing for their lives? Or are they causing you to kind of go back to slavery, go back to Egypt? And they're in this middle. He says, be strong and courageous, for you shall cause this people to inherit the land. Only be strong and very courageous, being careful to do according to all that the law, Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right or the left, that you may have good success wherever you go. The book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate it on day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened. Do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. They're in the middle, and God is like, hey, be strong and courageous. Be strong and very courageous. At the end of the chapter, the people tell him, because they saw a generation that died off and not get into the promise. It's a new generation rising up. And not only does God tell them three times, but later on in that chapter, the Israelites like, hey, be strong and courageous. I think God wants us today to be strong and courageous as we're in the middle about to head into promise. They were in the middle of their past and future promises. Israel cries out, God saves them. Like, God does that. Israel cries out when they're in slavery, God does that. But to go into their promises, God wants to partner with them and them actually do something. And I think this is a lot of how Christians can be today, where they get saved, they cry out, God, take this thing away from me. Help me, God. And they come to a church service, or they're at a small group study. They come into the family of Jesus. They get saved. And a lot of times that's where they end up saying, man, I'm all good, because at least I'm not in slavery. But God actually wants more for us. He wants to move us into promise. And so they're in this middle. Baby, I don't even know the words. Da-da, da-da, in the middle. I don't know the words. My daughter wanted me to sing that. I didn't do a good job, Bella. Sorry. God saved them, but they were stuck. They were in the middle. Let's pray, guys. God, we love you. We thank you for your grace, your mercy, and your love, God, that you would show up in a great way to challenge us today to move towards our promises. In Jesus' name, amen. So I really love my family. If the whole family, no, I'm just joking. Would you please? No, I'm just kidding. I love my family. My in-laws are here. I love you guys. Thank you so much for coming. And I just love my family. And if you knew where I grew up, you'd be like, man, how did you get that family? And I'm so grateful for them and love our family time. We have this obsession a little bit with this game show called Beat Shazam. Has anybody heard of Beat Shazam? Anybody? Yes. Yes, one person. It was one person in the last service too. It's with Jamie Foxx. Has anybody heard of Jamie Foxx? Love Jamie Foxx. And the way that it works is they have three teams, and they play a song from different genres and eras. And the team that guesses the fastest can go against Shazam and win $1 million. So how many of you guys like music? Okay, cool, thank you. One person. We're going to take a – I Googled the most nostalgic songs over the last 50 years. There was a bunch of them. These are the ones I chose. And so let's see if you remember these songs. So this is the 70s. Name it out. Staying Alive. I see a few people like moving. They're like, oh, it's church. Should I do this? I don't know. In the 80s, here's the 80s. Blurt it out. That's not the name of the song. Don't you forget it, Mammy. There you go. From Simple Minds. We're getting close to the 90s. Who said, oh? Oh, I see. Backstreet Boys. Come on, guys, help me out. Oh, dang, she got the whole moves down, everything. The 2000s. Oh, some of y'all. Oh, I heard this one. Oh, oh, I can see it. Call me maybe. I think you won every one. So, this is nostalgia. It takes us back. And it takes us back to a simpler time sometimes. The nostalgia kind of, you reminisce. And the definition of nostalgia, I have it on the screen, says a sentimental longing or wistful affection for the past. So I got it right here. Sentimental longing or wistful affection for the past. It's easy to be reminded and fall in love with the past. We romanticize it. It's the good old days. It's the simpler times. I think the greatest music, and you can argue with me all night, you just will not win. The greatest music of all time, to me, was 90s R&B. It's just my favorite. Favorite bands, Jodeci. Okay, y'all know Jodeci? We're going to talk after. But I love this. And the crazy thing is with nostalgia, if you're not careful, there's a danger because you start to kind of obsess a little bit. And if you over-romanticize it, because I love that music, it takes me back. But I start to forget the childhood trauma that I had, the relationships or the things that happened to us. And we start to, I was reading some studies about this, if we're not careful when we're faced with challenges and decisions that may be a little difficult in the future, we start to, it's easy to look at simpler times. It's easy to get nostalgic. And so we don't pursue promises, job offers, relationships as a it's too tough. So I'm gonna go back to simpler times. Nostalgia. And Israel did this same exact thing in Numbers 11. Said, but you remember the fish we ate in Egypt that cost nothing. The cucumbers, the melons, and here they're in the middle right now. The leeks, the onions, the garlic. But now our strength is dried up and there's nothing at all but this manna we look at. And God brought them out of slavery. God brought them from being beaten. The miracles, the impossible, parting the sea. And they're literally looking at manna, bread from heaven. And they're looking at the thing that God basically, if they wouldn't have had the manna, they would have died. So they're looking at the thing that God delivered them from. Like, man, I kind of wish I was beaten still. I kind of just rather have some onions. And I think we do that a lot of times, God. It gets difficult in the future. It gets difficult. And it's just like, man, it's just tough. Life is hard. I wish I was 13 again. I wish I could go back. I wish I could do that thing over again because this river, this storm, this trial, this relation, whatever, this job, it's just too hard. And we sometimes look at all that God has done. It's a danger, guys. We look at all that God has done for us and we look at it with a different set of eyes because we're obsessing over the past. And we end up like this guy here. There's God's promises in the future. There's God's promises in the future. He's got it. This is how a lot of Christians are, real talk. And they're looking at the past like, man, it was easy back in the day. You know, I was going to say that. And Jesus talks about this romanticizing in Luke. He says, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit to enter the kingdom of God. No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. God wants to move us forward. He wants to push us forward. It takes work. It takes plowing. But sometimes we're in the middle and we get stuck. We get stuck and obsessed over nostalgia and the things at a simpler time. The problem with nostalgia is it keeps us from moving forward. And this is where the people of God are at in this story right now. And the way we read the Bible is we try to read it by reread it. We find out what was happening then and what was God trying to teach these people and how can we apply that today in our life. So I'm going to share three things today that God taught them and hopefully can teach us to pursue the promise, the promises of God. The Bible talks we go from glory to glory to glory. And so the first one is faith leads to obedience. Faith leads to obedience. God commanded, said, arise and go. We all have rivers, seas, storms. Some of us are probably going through those. And some of you are probably watching right now, and this is my message. He's talking to me because I'm going through a storm, going through a struggle. There's a river right in front of me. Keep in mind, with this river right here in front of them, it's crisis time because it's flood season. It's at its highest right now. So they understand it. Notice how Joshua didn't make boats. He knew that God had already parted the seas. Got a little bit of history and relationship with God as a result of what he's done in the past. And then he'll do it again. Will he do it? Won't he do it? Faith can be measured through obedience. God commanded them. Joshua obeyed and worked out his faith. We got to work out our faith. The Bible says faith without works is dead. Can you imagine if God told Noah, God said, hey, there's a flood coming. So it's going to rain. Build an ark. Like, you got to do something. And imagine if Noah's like, yeah, that's awesome. I believe in you, God. Thank you for taking me out of my past issues. But I believe in you, and he doesn't build the ark. That's what faith is, doing and obeying what God says. We can't just have faith. We have to tie it to obedience. The crazy thing about listening and obeying to God, I remember I was in my early 20s, and I was a knucklehead at the time and had a lot of depression at the time. And I remember at about 7 or 8 o'clock, a mentor, pastor friend of mine, during my depression, during the middle, I'm saved, but I'm still depressed. I'm saved, still have things going on, saved. But man, I still feel this pressure in my life, and I don't know. I couldn't even think of the promises that God had for me at that time. And we can be in that middle. He says, hey, we're going. I'm picking you up at 4 a.m. We're going to Washington. And I tell you what, I did not want anything to do with church at the time. Long story short, there was reconciliation, prayer on the way to this 12-hour trip to go to Othello, Washington. And in the midst of the middle, I felt like God was saying, you need to go. You need to have faith that things are going to be restored, that things are going to work out for you. And crazy thing, if I would have said no to this trip, I would have never met my beautiful wife. And I would have never met my beautiful wife on that trip as a result of going and acting in obedience when God told me to go and I didn't want to. And so God's been faithful. God's been faithful to us. We make decisions, we go on faith, and we don't know what's gonna happen. And I have the beautiful family that I do as a result of being obedient to God. So the faith, it's not this mental thing. As Christians, we're told to walk by faith, but what is faith? What is walking by faith actually mean? The Hebrew word for faith, to walk, is halakha. Someone say halakha? Halakha was the way that you live your life. More specifically, you got to hear me in this entire message. The halakha is the way you live by life. So you halakha You walk halakha by faith. You walk by faith. It's specifically to do with the way that you apply God's word to your life. In Jesus's day, your halakha was the most important part of your faith. This is Jewish thinking because it determined the way that you behaved and acted. So when we say we walk by faith, not by sight, what does that actually mean? It's like, is that just an idea or a mental posture? Like, I'm gonna halakha, I'm gonna have faith that God's... No, you actually have to read and apply God's word and obey it. And that brings me to my point number two. The Bible needs to form us, not just inform us. If we want to halakha, if we want to walk, we need to read the Bible. The halakha is how we apply the word, not how we apply cultural Christianity to our lives, not how we just, I'm just going to worship. That's not halakhaing. Halakha is to read and apply God's word. You apply by obedience. You have to obey. In verse 7, it says, only be strong and very courageous, being careful to do according to the law that Moses, my servant, commanded. Do not turn from the right or to the left, that you may have good success wherever you go. The book of the law, because this is all they had back then. I promise, like, the disciples didn't have the Bible back then. This is stuff that they're reading from their ancestors. But you shall meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous and then you'll become successful. The word meditate means to ruminate. It's kind of gross, and I read about this in a book by Greg Rochelle, Winning the War Within a Mind, and to meditate and ruminate is basically cows, they regurgitate and throw up what they just ate. They do this because they're trying to break it down because they have four different compartments in their stomach. Some people say they have four stomachs, but it's actually four compartments of their stomach. So they're doing that as the way that of their life. And so when we read the Bible, it's hard just to read it, and then I'm going throughout my day. But he's telling Joshua, and I'm telling you, when we read the Bible, we have to meditate on it day and night. So not only do we have to read it, because that's the halakha, we're applying God's word to our life, but we have to be fascinated. We have to chew it up. We have to digest it. 2 o'clock comes around, man, what was I reading earlier? Man, you have to meditate it. You have to chew it. You have to be fascinated by it. You have to read your Bible. Like, you have, no one claps for reading the Bible. I go to church, though. I go to church. I worship. On my way to work, I listen to Maverick City. I know every song. But if you want a halakha, the thing that was most important to your faith, you have to apply God's word to your life. So what? How do I find out God's word for my life? I just got to read the Bible. Got to read the Bible. The Christian walk, the halakha, is much more than going to church. It's much more than listening to worship. It's much more than watching a 2 to 3 minute sermon on Instagram that has some cool music and text over it, and it's just really cool. And then that's all we become, is these cultural Christians. I got saved in my 20s, and therefore, like, I'm good. I got a heritage. I grew up in church. All my family, we love God. But are you halakhaing? Are you walking? Are you applying the word of God? Are you reading the word of God in your life? It's almost like, how many like basketball? Any Jordan fans in here? Michael Jordan. Imagine if Michael Jordan was like, Eric, I know you love basketball and you want to go to the NBA. I'm going to sit down with you every day. We're going to shoot hoops. And I'm going to show you, I'm going to tell you, you bent your legs a little too much, or you did this, and, you know, probably put a little bit more arc on it. It's a lot like wanting to learn golf and Tiger Woods teaching you, but, you know, like, know what, Tiger? Know what? No worries, Michael. I'm actually watching your highlights. I'm actually just going to watch you on TV. I'm going to watch The Last Dance on Netflix. We have the greatest of all time, God the Father, His Word, Jesus, His Word, the Holy Spirit, to guide us. And we're like, know what? I'm going to just, I'm just going to go to church every once in a while. I'm going to watch the online stream. I'm going to just check out social media posts online. And that's my relationship. Guys, I love that you come to church. I love that you come to church, but you got to read your Bible. You have got to read your Bible. Well, what are the promises of God? There's over 3,000 promises of God in the Bible. Read the Bible. There's over 3,000. Lots of them. If we want to walk by faith, the halakha, we got to read. We got to read the word. And we got to value what the Bible says for our lives and prioritize those things over the voices of others. And when we're in the middle, we need the Bible to give us clarity while we're in the middle. And the last thing, I'm excited, y'all. Whew. The last thing we need to do is be reminded. We need to be reminded of God's faithfulness. Got to be reminded. So in chapters 3 and 4 of Joshua, I encourage you to read like the first 4 chapters of Joshua. It's powerful because it's so relevant to us today. When they're crossing over, God commands them, I want you to make 12 stones. I want you to build a memorial as a sign to show my faithfulness to your sons and daughters. So they basically create a memorial. Now, the difference between a memorial and nostalgia is nostalgia really obsesses over the past, really prevents us from moving forward, and we kind of just romanticize on what the way it used to be, and we end up stuck that way. But a memorial says, you know what, God has taken me out of Egypt, he's parted the seas, and won't he do it again? And that's the powerful thing about memorials. We're reminded of God's faithfulness. Has he not been faithful to you? Okay, has God not been faithful to you guys? He's been faithful, and so we have to create these reminders of all of his faithfulness. We went to Pebble Beach, my wife and I, when we got married, and they say you're not actually allowed to take the rocks. You're not allowed to take the pebbles. And so my wife was a lot more Christian back then than I was. And so she told me, she saw the sign, she's like, I want one of those. But she didn't want to go get it. She wanted me to go to jail. And on Pebble Beach. And so I grabbed it, and it was like this reminder of God's faithfulness. You gotta understand, there's this thing called the ACE test. The ACE test is childhood trauma before the ages of 18. And after 4, you're severe childhood trauma. Guys, I scored a 9 on this thing. The trauma, I scored my wife, she's like a 0. And so if you know me and you know where I've been, the things that I've had to suffer, the things and the pain that I've had to deal with, this it's just this rock to me, guys. But I look at that, I just am moved by God's faithfulness. And we have to, sometimes it's okay to be moved to tears by God's faithfulness, because he's brought us not only out of slavery, but through the middle across the Jordan River. The powerful thing about this story is they were carrying the Ark of the Covenant the whole time. And as they were carrying the Ark of the Covenant, the moment that they got to the edge, the water receded. And the Ark of the Covenant represents the presence of God, literal presence in the Old Testament, the literal presence of God. And so they go, they wait, and everyone goes through to the other side of the river. And then the Ark of the Covenant, they end up on land and everything starts to crash. Isn't it amazing? Isn't it amazing that God goes before us? His literal presence, we need his presence to go before us and come behind us. It's just a memorial, but it means so much to me. I encourage you guys, create memorials of things. Write them down. I have this tattoo here called, it just says God's Son, but it's a reminder to me. My real father left when I was 3. My stepdad did some crazy stuff to our family where he ended up going to prison and getting deported. And so I grew up fatherless or bad examples. And I come to this church and I get this spiritual father and mother, God's Son. I'm reminded by being here in God's presence that Man, I'm God's son. He's been faithful to me. So just encourage you, whether it's a little quote or something on your wall or whatever, man, build a memorial, a sign of God's faithfulness, because if he's done it before, it's a reminder that he'll do it again. In the middle, on the edge of the river, it's difficult to trust God when you're going through it. One thing I've found in my life is that when there's about to be a breakthrough, there's a lot of chaos. And you got to press in. You got to trust God even more at that time. His presence, his Holy Spirit to guide you. The halakha, reading his word, applying it, being obedient. And the story of Joshua, it's so relevant for us today. We find ourselves in the middle. I'm saved. But man, are we truly living out the promises of God? Joshua was told by God, you're going to cause people to inherit the promises. Sometimes this becomes a very selfish faith, which I'm saved, I'm good, go to church, go home, work. I'm providing for my family. I read a tweet about God's quote. I think that's in the Bible. But he wants more. He wants to partner with you to pursue the promises and cross over the river, even though it may be scary. You got to be strong and courageous. The three things we learn from Joshua's story is that we got to have faith. It leads to obedience. We need to obey the halakha. We need to read our word, apply the word. Can you be married if you don't talk to your wife? On paper, probably. It's a pretty lousy marriage, though. No intimacy. Question, can you be Christian if you don't read your word and become intimate with Jesus? Probably, you're maybe, but God wants so much more. He created this world, this word, the Bible for us. You gotta read it. You gotta read your Bible. There's one thing you could take tomorrow, today. Read your Bible, meditate on it, day and night. Watch what God does and speaks to you. It's easy to say that God is faithful when there's things that come against us. But if we don't intentionally remind ourselves with signs and his word, it becomes very difficult to cross over. The last thing I'll say about being in the middle, I think of the verse, and I'm wrapping up, the verse that says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. It's Psalms 3, 4, or something like that. Psalms 23, you got it. And the fascinating thing, I used to be so scared of this valley. Ooh, it's scary. They thought I walked through the valley. This is scary. But the most powerful thing, my father-in-law is a farmer, grew up farming. And he says the valley is where the most fertile ground is because of the lake beds. And so this soil's fertile ground. That's why, and you look at California, the valley is, this goes, the farming there and the produce goes all over the world. Why? Because the fertile soil. And when we're going through the valley, when we're in the middle, just remind yourself that God is just building endurance. He's growing me. I'm gonna get through this because I've gotten through it before. So when we're in a valley, our perspective, when we're looking at the river, staring at a giant, staring at a storm, we just gotta know, God, you've been faithful before. I know you're building endurance. I don't know if I could do it without you, so I need your presence to go before me and come behind me. Guys, keep the faith. Be strong and courageous. Cross over. There may be some rivers, some jobs, some relationships that you gotta cut off, some things you gotta stop watching, some people you need to start. It's healthy to cut out things in your life that is keeping you from the promises of God. And maybe it's not a bad thing. Maybe it's a great job that you're just scared. I can't do it. The promises of God are literally for the Israel 11 days away. Your promises are on just on the other side of your courage to take massive action in your life. Put God first, read his word. Guys, I'm gonna pray. Let's pray, y'all. God, we love you so much. I pray for my friends, that even though they may be in the middle, God, just like Joshua in the story where they're up against a river, There's tension, there's angst, there's overwhelm, God. Maybe it's caused them to be complacent or stuck and romanticize and obsess over the past. But God, I pray that they would halakha, that they would walk by faith to come out of this, that they walk by faith in obedience to your word, to your Holy Spirit, that your supernatural enabling power, your presence would go before them and behind them, God. And today, God, that they will never be the same again. Amen. Let's go back into worship, guys. And give it your all when you're worshiping. Come on.